Hello everyone, welcome to Analoge IAS Current Affairs Analysis for 7th December 2019. These are the articles for the day. The first article for the day is titled Meals That Can Educate the Young. This is in the context of the midday meal scheme and the issues we face till now in the implementation of this scheme. Earlier this year, the Human Resource Development Ministry has received 35 complaints from 15 states and union territories regarding substandard quality of food in the midday meal schemes. This is in the past 3 years. Now let us try to understand what this midday meal scheme is all about. This midday meal scheme comes under the Human Resource Development Ministry's Department of School Education and Literacy. This is launched in the year 1995 as a centrally sponsored scheme. So what is the purpose of this scheme? Provides that every child within the age group of 6 to 14 years, that is kids in 1st to 8th classes who enroll and attend the schools, shall be provided with hot cooked meal having nutritional standards of 450 calories. If the kid is somewhere in 1st to 5th standard, and 700 calories for students in upper primary school, that is 6 to 8th. Also, the scheme mandates provision of 12 grams of protein as a part of this meal and 20 grams of protein if the student is in 6th to 8th standard. The scheme covers all the government and government aided schools. Even madrasas and maktabs supported under the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan are covered under this scheme. The last midday meal rules were notified in 2015 as per National Food Security Act 2013. Now let us have a look at some of the rules under this particular scheme. The rules mandate that the meal should be served only at school. Secondly, the meal shall be prepared in accordance with the midday meal guidelines issued by the central government from time to time. Few other latest guidelines provide instructions on procuring AGMA quality items for preparation of midday meals, tasting of meals by 2 or 3 adult members of the school management committees, including at least one teacher before serving to children. If the midday meal is not provided in school on any school day due to non-availability of food grains or any other reason, the state government shall pay a food security allowance by 15th of the next month. It is the state government, not the central government. Also, under the Right to Free and Compulsory Education Act 2009, there are school management committees. Now, these school management committees are mandated to monitor the implementation of midday meal scheme. The State Steering and Monitoring Committee shall oversee the implementation of the scheme, including establishment of a mechanism for maintenance of nutritional standards and quality of meals. The government provides financial support to the eligible schools or implementing agencies in the form of free food grains and by bearing cooking related costs. Now, this is the background of midday meal scheme. Now, it is integrated with Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. And this particular article is talking about the quality issues and inconsistencies that occur from time to time in midday meal schemes. As a part of the midday meal scheme, every child is entitled to receive around 150 ml of milk every single day. However, a recent video in rural Uttar Pradesh showcased how a single liter of milk was mixed with a bucket full of water so that it would be sufficient for more than 80 children. This adulteration is a serious cause of concern, and the author also points out to the procedural lapses in cases where there was serious flouting of norms on midday meal schemes. The author quotes an incident where 23 children died after eating a meal because the oil used for cooking the meal was stored in a can that originally contained a pesticide. So it was used even without washing properly. This event received global coverage and However, after the issue died down in the media, there was no progress on that particular case. Even in the latest case of Uttar Pradesh, the steps taken were very nominal because there was no long-lasting action from the part of the authorities. Now, coming to the central issue, generally the stories that are seen in media are of three kinds. One, it is the case of bad food quality. Second one is about the cases where cheating is happening in the midday meal scheme. Or third, it is about how caste bias and caste discrimination is seen at midday meal scheme. Instances where district collectors have to come down personally and ensure that they have a meal become stories of importance to the media because of the day-to-day caste discrimination seen at schools. Now, we often emphasize midday meal scheme as an idea for the poor and for only government and aided schools. The fact that health and nutrition are also a problem for the rich and the private schools is completely ignored by media as well as the government. So this brings us to the first question. Why not have a midday meal scheme in private schools as well? Secondly, the second issue is looking at midday meal scheme as an issue of charity rather than with compassion and as an entitlement to the kid. More and more government schools are seen as institutions for the poorest of the poor sections of the society, and even if the parent is a bit well off, the child is being shifted to the private sector. Why are we not emphasizing on state funded education system and state funded schemes like midday meal schemes universally? The third issue is lack of awareness. Even the well-to-do southern states like Kerala, which have better social indicators than their northern counterparts, do not insist on maintaining a record of what they are eating and tracking the progress on their nutritional requirements. This generally shows that there is a lack of awareness even in the well-to-do states. The author concludes that more than anything, incidents like adulteration of milk happening right in front of their eyes will disturb the psychological and moral build-up of the child, and who will convince the child whether honesty is the right policy or not? Will he be convinced in such kind of an institutional setup? That is the question we have to ask ourselves. In this context, try to answer this question. Midday meal needs an institutional as well as perception change to act as a game changer it was envisaged to be. Elucidate. The next article is titled Seeking Truth and Reconciliation in Chhattisgarh. This is taken from the Hindu, and this is regarding the fake encounter case that happened 6 years ago. This article is regarding the plight of villagers in areas with left-wing extremism and how they are sandwiched between Maoists as well as the security forces. A recent judicial probe by Justice Vijay Kumar held that 17 villagers were killed by the Chhattisgarh police in a fake encounter on 28th June 2012 in Bijapur district of Chhattisgarh. Later, they were also labeled as Maoist. The report, which leaked to the media on Sunday, indicates that police suggested that the people were killed in a gunfight were not Maoists. According to the security forces, a joint team of the CRPF and the Chhattisgarh police came across a meeting of the Maoists in Sarkeguda around the night of 28 June 2012. The security forces claimed that they were fired upon by the Maoists, to which they retaliated. This claim was refuted by the villagers, who said that those killed in the firing were civilians and that they had gathered that night to discuss the preparations for a traditional festival. The report said that the police claim of firing from the villagers' side was wrong, and the security forces could not provide any proof of the targeted group being Maoists. After questions were raised over the death of 17 people in Sarkeguda village, the BJP government constituted a one-member judicial inquiry commission. This whole episode points its finger to a simple lapse of rule of law. What we need here is a truth and reconciliation commission which would catalog and compensate for all the deaths and prosecute those who are responsible for those deaths. Action against security personnel in Sarkeguda must be the start for a paradigm shift in the way governance is being carried out, especially policing, in these left-wing extremist states. This should not be an end point but a starting point for a new phase of handling left-wing extremism. Let us use this opportunity to look at what are the various government strategies to curb left-wing extremism. The first one is Samadhan strategy. This Samadhan strategy is a one-stop solution for the left-wing extremism problem. It encompasses the entire strategy of government from short-term policy to long-term policy, formulated at different levels. So S stands for smart leadership, A stands for aggressive strategy, M stands for motivation and training, A stands for actionable intelligence, D stands for dashboard-based key performance indicators, H stands for harnessing technology, A stands for action plan for each theater, and N stands for no access to financing. This sums up our initiatives on various fronts that are contentious issues in left-wing extremism. Also, we came up with national strategy to counter left-wing extremism in 2015. So, this was formed as a multi-pronged approach to combat left-wing extremism with a main aim to ensure participatory governance and protection of the rights of local tribals. The last thing that the government emphasized was on intelligence sharing and raising of separate 66 Indian Reserve battalions. This was done by the government to curb the menace of left-wing extremism. Also, few schemes were being implemented by the government to ensure the development of these areas. They include road connectivity projects, skill development, educational projects, installation of mobile towers, initiatives to ensure financial inclusion, a special central assistance for filling critical gaps in public infrastructure. All these activities were taken up to ensure development of left-wing extremism. Despite such progress, fake encounters like this will only create a gap between the tribals and the officials in that particular area. The last article for the day is taken from Indian Express and it is titled Criminals in Uniform. Yesterday, the four accused in gang rape and murder of a 27-year-old woman in Hyderabad were shot dead. The police said that the accused were taken to the scene for reconstruction of the crime. However, they attacked the police and tried to escape, so the police had to shoot them down. The horrible crime committed by these accused in Hyderabad rape case shook the collective conscience of India and resulted in an outcry for justice, both for the victim and his family. The outrage over the persisting lack of safety for women in public spaces has definitely put pressure on institutions of judiciary as well as the police. The police must have been under tremendous pressure to catch the culprits and hold them accountable for what they have done. There was also pressure on judiciary to complete the legal process without undue delay. There were protests across the states and also across the country. However, extrajudicial killings like this must be looked down through the lens where these institutions failed to uphold the rule of law and procedure even in such circumstances. We have to read this article very carefully because this is written by Julio Ribeiro. He was also called the super cop, a retired Indian police officer and civil servant who had a big role in responsible positions during the Punjab insurgency period. In 1987, he was also given the Padma Bhushan Award, which is the third highest civilian award for his service. In his lifetime, he was also attacked by Khalistani commando forces, and twice in 1986 and 1991, there were failed assassination attempts. Also, he was a part of many committees that handled issues pertaining to the reforms and criminal justice system. So his words must be taken very carefully because they come in with a lot of experience. Mr. Ribeiro says that third degree methods like torture and fake encounters have gained popularity with people because of the frustration with the judicial system. However, they are shortcuts which glorify the role of police and sideline their actual role. The author warns that the public is unaware of the fallout of this new practice of fake encounters that is backed by public support as well as political legitimacy. These encounter specialists are often worshipped as heroes. This culture of glorification should eventually be replaced by a reformed criminal justice system that is based on rule of law. That is what this author is trying to say. Now, criminal justice system encompasses judiciary, the police, and also prison reforms. With respect to judiciary, if we can have daily hearing in such high profile cases without any interruptions or without any adjournments, and if the lawyers are busy with other cases, all the steps that can be done to attend to these high priority cases are ensured, then there will be reform in judiciary. Along with this, there should be reform in the way policing is done in India. Firstly, we are heavily understaffed, and secondly, there is no sensitization. Supreme Court in Prakash Singh case in 2006 issued certain directives regarding police reforms. Till now, most of the states have not implemented that particular set of directions from Supreme Court. And as far as prison reforms are concerned, we have NCRB data which says that most of the prisons are overcrowded and most of the prisoners lying around in those prisons are under trains. This goes back to our fundamental problem, that is incapacity of judiciary to fastly resolve the cases. So the first priority should be given to judicial reforms in our country and ensure that rule of law is not a fancy word but a norm in day-to-day functioning. That's it for the day. Thank you.